الحمد لله الذي أحسن كل شيء خلقه وبدأ خلق الإنسان من طين وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ألا وإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. يقول الله تعالى في كتابه الكريم وأصدق القائلين: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. I bear witness that there is none worthy of our worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the seal of the prophets and the final messenger to all of humanity. Whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides, there is none to misguide, and whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leaves to stray, there is none to guide aright. يحتفي المسلمون في هذا الوقت من العام بمولد خير البرية سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. So at this time of the year we commemorate the birth of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. I didn't say celebrate, I said commemorate. Even Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم himself commemorated his birth. He was asked, why do you fast on Mondays? He said, this is the day I was born. So this is a beautiful day. This is a wonderful day from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The day Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was born. And if you commemorate some of these Islamic events like Badr or Bay'at al-Ridwan and al-Isra'i wal-Mi'raj, by remembering the lessons we can learn from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his sunnah, and we teach our kids and we follow his example, this is the best way to commemorate the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and such Islamic events. فكما ذكرت يحتفي المسلمون بمولد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهذه فرصة طيبة لنعلم أولادنا عن حياة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وصفاته وأخلاقه وسنته وهو شيء نفعله طول السنة صراحة لأن كل الدروس وكل الخطب التي نخطبها في الجمعة وفي المناسبات وفي الأعياد هي تتعلق بحياة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيعني نحن لا نخصص فقط يوم الجمعة في ربيع الأول أو غير ذلك للحديث عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ولكن كل العام نحن نتكلم عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وسنته وأخلاقه إلى غير ذلك. So as I said, the whole year we talk about Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم about his أخلاق and his manners and so on and so forth. وذكرنا في العام الماضي أن كل المسلمين يحب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. We all love Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Every single one of us, even those who are not practicing the religion, they love Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. يعني كل الناس يحب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى من لا يتبع هديه الإنسان الذي لا يصلي هو يحب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وإذا أسيء إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فهو يكون من أول الناس الذين ينتصرون له. So even those who don't pray, they don't practice the sunnah of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. If someone said something bad about Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, they will be the first one to defend him even if they don't practice his sunnah. We love him صلى الله عليه وسلم ونحب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فكثير من الناس يطلقون اسم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على أبنائهم يعني لا أتصور أنه في هذا المسجد إنسان يعني اسمه الأول ليس محمد أو إنسان ليس في مثلا الميدل نيم تبع محمد أو اسم العائلة محمد. I cannot imagine that there is a household in the Muslim world where you don't find someone's first name to be Muhammad or someone in the family whose middle name is Muhammad or last name is Muhammad. And I mentioned last year, Al-As ibn Wa'il, لما مات أبناء النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الذكور يعني قال انقطع عقب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فهو أبتر. So he said that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, as soon he dies, no one will remember his name because all of his kids died in his lifetime. He was talking about the boys, the three of them. He said, once he dies, no one carries his name will be forgotten. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرَ فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرَ. So now, after 1500 years from the passing of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Over 150 million people have the name Muhammad. Even if you go to London, UK, the name Muhammad is the number one boy name. Of course, there are different spellings, M-O-H-A-M-E-D, M-O-H-A-M-M-A-D, or E-D, or M-U, and so on and so forth. So together, the name Muhammad is the number one name, even in some non-Muslim countries. So we love him, and we name our children after him. And I think I gave the example of one of the imams in the U.S. when he said that someone asked him, your name is Muhammad al-Ashir, Muhammad the 10th. So is al-Ashir your last name? He said, no, this is my number. Because every man in the family, their name is Muhammad. His father is Muhammad, his grandfather is Muhammad, his brother is Muhammad, his son is Muhammad, everyone is Muhammad. So he said, to identify ourselves, we go by numbers. So my father was Muhammad the 9th, I'm Muhammad the 10th, and my son is Muhammad the 11th, right? So they don't confuse people. They go by numbers. So everyone loves Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's a most commonly given name in the world, and this is a sign of love for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now, yes, we love Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is no question about this. And we know the reason. لَأَنَّهُ يَعْنِي أَهْلٌ لَأَنْ يُحَبْ The Prophet ﷺ deserves to be loved. Because he cares about us more we care about ourselves. Because if you follow your nafs will motivate you to do haram, do this, drink, date, drugs. Because you think if you fulfill your desires, you are doing yourself a favor. But you are giving yourself jahannam, actually. But Muhammad ﷺ, there is nothing we do as Muslims except that Muhammad ﷺ told us to do. You will never find a hadith where the Prophet ﷺ said, don't give sadaqah, don't do something good, don't have good akhlaq. And you can never find a hadith where the Prophet ﷺ says, you have to abuse people, you have to cheat, you have to lie. This will never happen. مَا أَمَرَ إِلَّا بِخَيْرٍ وَمَا نَهَى إِلَّا عَنْ شَرٍ Every time the Prophet ﷺ tells you to do something, it has to be good for you in dunya and in akhirah. And if he tells you to stay away from something, then it has to be wrong in dunya and in akhirah. And when Muslims live in non-Muslim countries, and I say this in a positive way, wallahi, the non-Muslim societies, they should be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Muslims follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They don't lie. I'm talking about true Muslims who follow the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They don't lie. They don't cheat. They don't abuse people. Why? Because Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them to do it this way. So they should be grateful that Muslims follow the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. طبعا, if you want to prove your love to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, من أراد أن يثبت حبه للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فأفضل وسيلة هو اتباع سنته. إذ كيف يحب الإنسان إنسانا ويعصاه. So if you want to show your true love to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, follow his sunnah, follow his example. This is a sign of true love. If you love someone, you obey them. Your kids will tell you, yes, I love you and everything. And if you tell them, go up, they go down. Go right, they go left. What kind of love is this? إِنَّ الْمُحِبَّ لِمَنْ يُحِبُّ مُطِيعُ If you love someone, you obey them. This is the sign, this is a proof of your true love for them. So, مَحَبَّةِ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ وَاتِّبَاعِ أَخْلَاقِهِ If you represent his manners and his akhlaq, especially in this society, when you represent Islam, you show your manners and you show your true love for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by embodying his message and his sunnah, people will see Islam in you. You can talk about how good Islam is for 2 months. But if you show it in your manners and your akhlaq, this is a better representation of Islam. To be a true Muslim, as I said, you follow the akhlaq of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if you are a true Muslim, you're honest, you're kind, you're sincere, because this is what Islam means. If you say you are Muslim, but you don't follow his sunnah and embody his akhlaq in your manners, for me, this is like someone who says, I'm vegetarian, and mashallah, every day they eat beef and chicken. Tamam? And the man delicious, and the burger factory every single day. How do you claim to be vegetarian if you eat beef and chicken every day? And how can you claim to be a true Muslim, a true follower of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if you don't follow his akhlaq and his manners? You're shooting yourself in the foot. One of the most important akhlaq or manners we can learn from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is al-hilm. Wallahi, this is the one of the most beautiful manners we can learn from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-hilm. It is difficult to translate in English, but al-hilm basically comes down to grace and being gracious and responding to evil with good and show people your akhlaq. They are not your teachers. Like in the story of Umar al-Mukhtar, for example, when they took captives and his sahaba said, okay, we want to discipline them just like they torture and abuse our captives. He said, they are not our teachers. Our teacher is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They are not our teachers. We have to show them how good and how true Muslims we are. So you show this matter in your akhlaq al-hilm. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, min hilmihi, إنه كان يحول العدو إلى صديق. One of the great qualities of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's very clear in his sunnah that he always turned enemies into friends. وهم يقولون كذا الإنسان العاقل هو من يحول العدو إلى صديق والإنسان اللي هو الأحمق من يحول الصديق إلى عدو. So they say a smart person is someone who turns enemies into friends. But an idiot will always turn friends into enemies by their manners and bad manners and al-akhlaq. You can always win over people's hearts by your manners, how good and kind you are. You will win the battle, inshallah, against your nafs and against shaitan. So I remember many years ago, everyone loves corn. So we got the pot, we put the corn, and it, alhamdulillah, boiled, and it was ready to eat. But I can't eat it hot, and I had to cool it down a bit. So I took it to the tap, I opened the tap water, and the water was coming down, and when I took the corn, it was still hot. And I realized, because the water that was coming from the tap was also hot. It was hot water coming. So when you meet someone's disrespect with disrespect, things will be heated, one thing will lead to another. But if you respond with kindness and grace and respect, people will cool down. Just like the example I gave. And the examples are so many. I'm going to give some examples from the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how he responded to people. And this is something we need to apply in our daily lives. With your wife, with your husband, with your children, with your parents, and so on and so forth. Wallahi, kindness will win over people's hearts. And kindness and grace is the best da'wah. Even with non-Muslims, kindness and grace is the best da'wah. There is this hadith in Bukhari. جاء أعرابي إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وتعرفون الحديث في البخاري. فجاء الرجل ومعه ناقتين. ناقتان عشان أبو علي ما يزعلش مننا. فقال احمل لي من مال الله الذي عندك فليس المال مالك ولا مال أبيك. So he came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, this Arabi. He had two camels with him. And he said, I want you to load these camels with food entrusted to you by Allah, because this food is not yours, it is not your father's food. It doesn't belong to you. And he was very disrespectful, according to this hadith in Bukhari. And he pulled the Prophet from his clothes until he almost hurt his neck. And the Sahaba were there, and Anas radiallahu anhu said, I was stunned when I saw the man doing this to the Prophet. The Prophet smiled, and he said, yes, inshallah, we'll give you, but I have to retaliate. I will have to do the same thing to you. So the man said, you can't do that. So the Prophet ﷺ said, walima, why? He said, لَأَنَّكَ لَا تُقَابِلُ السَّيِّئَةَ بِالسَّيِّئَةِ وَلَكِنْ تَعْفُ وَتَصْفَحَ. You cannot do this because you are not like me. Because you don't respond to evil with evil, you respond to good with what is best. You are better than me. This is what he said, basically. So the Prophet ﷺ smiled, and he gave him two loads, camel loads, one dates and one barley. And يُحَمَّلَ لَهُ مِنَ الْتَمْرِ وَمِنَ الشَّعِيرِ. So this is in Bukhari. The Prophet ﷺ responded to him in this way. طبعاً في أحاديث أخرى, الحديث في صحيح مسلم, أُتي إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بذهبة من اليمن. A piece of gold was brought to the Prophet ﷺ from Yemen, and the Prophet ﷺ divided this gold between four people who either just accepted Islam or the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was hoping that they will become Muslim. He gave them. فجاء واحد من الناس وقال يا رسول الله اتق الله, what are you doing? So when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم divided this gold between four people, someone from the Sahaba was not happy. And he said, he came to the Prophet and said, Itaqillah, what is this? You didn't give me nothing. And he was yelling and he was saying this. So the Prophet said, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ إِذَا لَمْ أَتَّقِ If I don't have taqwa of Allah, who will have taqwa? That's all. Then the man left and Khalid ibn al-Walid was dead. The hadith is in Sahih Muslim and Khalid radiallahu anhu was mad. And he said, يَا دَعْنِي أَضْرِبَ عُنُقَ Let me fix him up for you. فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ دَعْهُ فَلَعَلَّهُ يَكُونُ يُصَلِّي The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, leave him alone because he prays, he makes salah, namaz. Leave him alone. فقال خالد يا رسول الله وكم من الناس يصلي وهو منافق خالد رضي الله عنه said, well, a lot of people, they make salah, they claim to be Muslims, but they have nifaq in their hearts. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما أمرت أن أشق بطون الناس ولا أن أطلع على قلوبهم The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, I've not been ordered to open people's bellies and look at their heart to see if they are munafiq or not. If they are Muslim, خلاص الحمد لله. So the Prophet ﷺ didn't do anything to the man. He let him go. Maybe you don't have a good day. Maybe someone, you know, did something terrible to you. This is not your lucky day. You are mad. And maybe you said something irresponsible. And we should not hold people accountable for everything they say. You don't know how terrible their day was. الحلم. And the examples are so many. And the Sahaba of the Prophet ﷺ embodied this hilm. And the great scholars of Islam embodied this hilm as well. One of the ulama, his name was Ibn Dhi'ib. كان من علماء المدينة وفقهاؤها. فدخل المسجد معروف إنه يعني في خلاف مسألة تحية المسجد في أوقات الكراهة وكذا. فعند الأحناف والمالكية يعني تكره الصلاة في هذا الوقت. وعند الشافعية تجوز صلاة تحية المسجد في أوقات الكراهة اللي هي بعد صلاة الفجر حتى طلوع الشمس وربع ساعة قبل أذان الظهر والوقت بعد صلاة العصر حتى المغرب فهو ابن أبي ذئب لم يصلي هو دخل المسجد وكان من علماء المدينة فجلس فقال له رجل من الناس لا يعرفه قال له جلوسك بدون تحية المسجد جهل وكان من أشراف الناس ومن العلماء ولكن هو يتبع المذهب الحنفي أو المذهب المالكي ما في صلاة خلاص فجلس فقال له جلوسك بغير تحية المسجد جهل تمام جهل مركب فوقف وصلى وبعد انتهاء الصلاة تحلق الناس حول ابن أبي ذئب ليتعلموا منه الفقه وغيره من العلوم فهذا الرجل يعني خجل واستحى وجاء وكلم الإمام وقال أنا آسف ما كنت أعرفك وكذا فقال لا عليك أمرتني بخير فأطعته So Ibn Abi Dhib, one of the great scholars of Medina, he was a scholar. And as you know, in fiqh, there are different opinions on praying two rak'ah tahiyyat al-masjid when you come in. So in the Maliki madhab, in the Hanafi madhab, based on authentic hadith, they don't pray. And these times in which salah is disliked is the time after salatul fajr until sunrise, 15 minutes before salatul dhuhr, adhan al-dhuhr, and the time after salatul asr until sunset. These are the disliked times. So, some of course, like in the Shafi'i madhab, they say if a salah has a name, you can pray it in these times. Like tahiyyatul masjid, if you forgot a sunnah, for example, and so on and so forth. You want to pray istikhara, janaza. This salah has a name, you can pray it in these times. But if you pray salah with no name, this is not allowed. So Ibn Abi Dhib followed one of those madhahib that says we cannot pray at these times. So he came inside the masjid and he sat, he didn't pray two rak'ah tahiyyat al-masjid. Someone from the people who think you can pray tahiyyat al-masjid, but he didn't know the imam, he didn't know that it was this big scholar Ibn Abi Dhib from Medina. So he told him, you sitting down without praying two rak'ah is a sign of compound ignorance. You are ignorant. Stand up and pray. He stood up and he prayed two rak'ah. Then after the salah, they prayed salatul isha or something, or salatul maghrib. Then the imam introduced Ibn Abi Dhib, one of the biggest scholars of the time, to give halaqah, give a talk to people. So this man who accused Ibn Abi Dhib of ignorance came to him apologizing, sorry, I didn't know. So the imam said, well, kuima salani, no problem, sorry, you told me to do something good, to pray two rak'ah, And I did it, alhamdulillah, it's not a big deal. You didn't tell me to do anything haram, and I listened to you. طبعا قصة مشابهة تروى عن الإمام مالك وهو من علماء الزمان الإمام مالك رحمه الله ورحم أبي حنيفة والشافعي والإمام أحمد وعلماء الإسلام جميعا فالإمام مالك من أنوار الإسلام وعلماء الزمان دخل المسجد ليصلي المغرب مثلا أو كذا أو صلاة الظهر فلم يصلي تحية المسجد وجلس هذا هو مذهبه فقال له صبي ولد صغير 7 سنوات يعني هكذا قال له اركع تركع يا شيخ تركع يعني عيب عليك تركع انت شيخ كبير هو لم يكن يعرف الإمام مالك قال تركع فوقف وركع صلى الركعتين وجلس فقال له بعض أصحابه يعني تستمع إلى طفل صغير وتصلي الركعتين وهذا يعني مكروه عندك في مذهبك فقال والله خشيت أن أكون ممن يقال لهم اركعوا لا يركعون والقصة أوردها الإمام القرطبي في تفسير سورة المرسلات في نهاية السورة So Imam Malik, one of the greatest scholars of all time, like Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Shafi'i, and Imam Ahmad, the greatest scholars of Islam. So one day in his madhab, as I said, they don't pray tahiyyat al-masjid. So he entered the masjid one day before Salatul Dhuhr, and he sat down. A little kid, about 7 years old, he told him, Ya Sheikh, what's wrong with you? Shame on you. You sit down, you don't pray tahiyyat al-masjid, 2 rak'ah, stand up and pray. He stood up, and he prayed 2 rak'ah. So after the salah, one of his students said, Ya Imam, we know in your madhab it is disliked to pray tahiyyatul masjid in this time. Why did you listen to this boy? He said, I was afraid that I would be from among those who are told make rak'ah and they don't make ruku'ah. And this is one of the ayat that talk about kuffar at the end of Surah Mursalat. So he said, I don't want to be among these people who are told make rak'ah, they don't make rak'ah. And the story is mentioned in Tafsir al-Qurtubi at the end of Surah Mursalat. He mentioned the stories. So al-hilm with people and being graceful to them, winning over their hearts. Now imagine if someone is sold 2 rak'ah masjid and they stand up and they fight in the masjid and the chairs are flying and you are not winning any game here. You are making fitna, you are dividing the ummah. Unless of course they are asking you to do something haram, right? But if it's something permissible, something that is allowed, something that is supported by hadith, then there is nothing wrong. Another example that I remember, if you are from India, Pakistan, you know Junaid Jamshid, rahimahullah. He passed away last year, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept him and give him Jannah. In his youth years, he was a singer, and eventually Allah guided him, he made tawbah, and he became da'ya. If you agree with him or you don't agree with him, he was trying to do something good, alhamdulillah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept him as shaheed. And the story was told by a brother from Markham, here in Canada. So he said, Junaid Jamshid came to Canada in a visit, and he entered one of the masajid in Markham to pray Salatul Isha, for example. One of the brothers brought their kids to the masjid. And you know what happens? Sometimes it's like, your kids are nice, mashallah, they are laughing, they are hugging you, everything is nice. And as soon as you go to the masjid, the speakers, he sees new people, they start to cry. What can you do? And wallahi, I'm totally against kicking kids out of the masjid. If they make noise, unless of course they tear the carpet or they break something. You know, as long as they're being kids, we need to teach them and accept them and give them candy or, you know, accept them. Because these are the future of Islam in this land. But if you kick them, if you yell at them and shout, get out of here, munafiq zindiq, then the perception they will have in their mind, this is a place where people scream at me and yell at me, I'm not going there again, right? But we need to correct them. Yes, they have to respect the masjid, but we do it, inshallah, in a nice way. So what happened, you know, the man was praying next to Junaid Jamshid, rahimahullah. He was standing next to him in the line with his son. As soon as the imam started the salah, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen, his kid started to cry. He tried to cool him down, you know. The more he tried to, you know, keep him quiet, the more the kid was like, oh, like everyone heard him in the masjid. So after salah, when they finished, and the man with his kid, he couldn't leave because he was in the middle of the masjid. He couldn't go anywhere, right? He was locked inside. So after salah, he looked around, he saw Junaid, and he recognized him. And he started to apologize, sorry, I ruined your salah, sorry, my kid was making noise. So Junaid, rahimahullah, said, he was very gracious. He said, maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept our salah because of the crying of your kids, of your son. Maybe this is the reason. If our salah is accepted, maybe it is accepted because of your son. You never know. And he left it at that. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us him, to give us the best in this life and the best in the life to come. Insha'Allah. الحمد لله رب العالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله ربه رحمة للعالمين. So the quality of حلم is one of the examples we need to apply from the life of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. If you truly love him, you follow his sunnah and his example. Try and apply حلم again, as I said, with your wife, your husband, your kid, your parents, the people you work with, the people you go to school with. And this will show you the beauty and the greatness of Islam. Over the last month, and I've seen this on CNN and ABC News and many news outlets in the US, a father from Kentucky, a Muslim brother, he lost his son. His son was delivering pizza and his son was stabbed by a guy, you know, from Kentucky, and his son was killed. And in the court, you probably saw the video. They allowed the father to speak, and he said, Muhammad and Islam teach us forgiveness and grace, and this is the reason I will forgive you, because this is something that Islam teaches. So the judge started to cry, and it was all over the news, and he started to preach, mashallah, about Islam and about Muhammad and about hilm and grace and mercy. And he whispered to the guy who killed his own son after he forgave him and hugged him, and he said, when you get out, try to do something good. And he said, Allah, maybe Allah will forgive you and accept you. And Allah cannot forgive you if I don't forgive you. But now I forgive you, the door of mercy of Allah and Rahmah is open for you. So he showed on national TV the hilm of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the akhlaq of Islam. And I'm sure this will touch so many people's hearts. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who touch people's hearts and embody the sunnah and the hilm of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we'll continue next week. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the best in this life and the best in the life to come. Nas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala an yaghfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina. Allahumma inna nas'aluka an tushaffi' fina nabiy sallallahu alaihi wasallam wa nas'aluka murafaqati fi jannati ya rabbal alamin. Allahumma ighfir li abaina wa ummahatina wa li jami'il muslimina ya rabbal alamin. وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وأقم الصلاة.